Members, good afternoon. It's the appointed time and we have a quorum. I call the meeting to order. Since the last meeting, no information paper has been issued. Items for discussion at the next meeting. As you can see at agenda item number 2, there is a list of outstanding items for discussion. For the third item today, that's report on the work of Competition Commission. Let's invite the government officials and the representatives of the Competition Commission to come in. On the 4th of June, thank you, Mr. Chan. Please be seated. At the next meeting, we will be discussing amendments to the Hong Kong Civil Aviation Investigation of Accidents Regulations, CAP 448B, and report on the work of the Air Accident Investigation Authority. Some of the members have not left the room. Let me talk about this. There is discussion on the development of tourism, culture, and tourism, and that will take place on the 28th of May. Mr. Ma Fong Kwok is going to chair the meeting, and that item will be discussed in the panel on culture, tourism, and sports. At the meeting, we will be discussing the items mentioned. If you're interested, you can join the meeting by ticking the box on your schedule. Welcome, Chairman Mr. Samuel Chan of the Competition Commission, and also Mr. Russell Butt, Chief Executive Officer of the Competition Commission, and Mr. Patrick Kwok, Executive Director of the Competition Commission, and Mr. Joey Tang, Principal Secretary for Commerce and Development and Economic Development. Chairman of the Competition Commission, please. Thank you. Thank you for giving us this opportunity to speak on this item. Mr. Russell Butt, CEO, and Mr. Patrick Kwok, Executive Director, and I will be reporting to members on the work of the Competition Commission since the last report in June 2023. We've been pushing ahead with our work and we have achieved results in terms of investigation and enforcement. We focus on anti-competition conduct concerning livelihood issues regarding funeral service and building maintenance. For two cases, we have achieved enforcement outcomes, one of which involve price fixing of property agents, and we have brought the case before Competition Tribunal, and also we've brought the case with the agreements among the two leading online food delivery platforms before the tribunal as well. Apart from this, the Competition Commission has been working on international and mainland liaison. In terms of our collaboration with the mainland in July last year, together with the Guangdong Administration for Market Regulation, we've signed a memorandum of understanding to promote competition laws in the Greater Bay Area and strengthen cooperation between the two authorities. In January this year, The Guangdong Administration for Market Regulation and the Commission co-published the Competition Compliance Manual for Business in Guangdong and Hong Kong to assist business operating in the GBA, especially SME, to better understand the competition law regimes in Hong Kong and Guangdong. In terms of international liaison, in August last year, we organized the Competition Enforcers and Academic Summit. We invited 100 leading scholars and senior enforcement officials from 12 Asia-Pacific economies and the mainland to exchange their insights and share experience. Participants of the summit gave us some positive feedback on the summit. In terms of public advocacy and education, the Commission have been reaching out to the members of public and different stakeholders. We have launched large-scale publicity campaigns, and we have events targeting younger generation. We will continue to perform our functions and to create a fair and competitive market for our stakeholders. Also, within this year, there have been three cases that have been brought before the Competition Tribunal, and hearings are underway. As we have more precedents relating to competition ordinance, we hope to create a set of theory so that we can provide more guidance to the commercial sector. Now let me ask our CEO, Mr. Butt, to talk about the work and the strategy of our commission. Thank you. Mr. Butt, please. Over the past year, the commission have been implementing our work through different areas. We continue to work with organizations in and outside Hong Kong. Locally, our commission have been working with other local enforcement agencies, including the police and the ICAC. For cases relating to anti-competitive conduct, apart from violating competition law, sometimes the defendants or offenders violate other laws as well. For big rigging, offenders may involve in triad society, and some offenders harass their competitors by threatening them from putting in a bid. These criminals sometimes bribe the companies organizing the tendering exercise. We want to collaborate with other law enforcement agencies to achieve synergy. Apart from this, as we integrate into the GBA, we will continue to strengthen collaborations with the mainland counterparts. Apart from exchanging experience and enhance our performance, where appropriate, we work with our mainland counterparts on various fronts. In terms of international liaison, our commission continues to participate in international events to share with other countries our local enforcement actions. I participated in an international competition events in Berlin, Germany. The participants told me that they were, well, they found it innovative for the local commission, competition commission, to have worked with other law enforcement agencies. Currently, we are working on organizing a high-level summit to invite leading scholars and senior enforcement officials to come to Hong Kong to look into different competition theories and to enhance collaboration among different jurisdictions. In terms of public advocacy and education, we make use of different ways to reach out to young people, SMEs, the business sector, along with other stakeholders in order for the SMEs to come up with appropriate compliance framework. We're working on an information gateway for the business sector, and that will be completed within this year. Now I will ask Mr. Patrick Kwok to talk about our enforcement over the past year. Please be brief. Thank you. I will briefly talk about our enforcement and investigations. From June last year to today, we have commenced initial assessment on 12 cases and commenced investigation against 3 cases. 2 cases involve funeral service operators. In August last year, we found out that some funeral service practitioners engaged in anti-competitive conduct, including suspected market sharing by coordinating their solicitation of customers. During our investigation, we found that the Funeral Trade Association and a number of funeral service companies are also suspected of having engaged in anti-competitive conduct. For these 2 cases, we have searched 13 premises, including the funeral service companies and Funeral Trade Association involved. For the 3rd case, in April, we have conducted joint operation with the ICAC against a suspected corruption and big rigging in building maintenance case. We have searched the premises of property management companies and building maintenance companies. We are still investigating into the case. Apart from these 3 cases that are under investigation, 2 of the cases have achieved enforcement outcomes. Fulfilling what Mr. Butt just mentioned, the case involving property agencies the case has been brought before the Competition Tribunal. That involves fixing minimum net commission rate. As for the 2 leading online food delivery platforms case, we have made use of non-litigation remedies. The 2 platforms offer to amend and remove the provisions concerning the 2 or concerning their partnering restaurants that might harm competition, so that the partnering restaurants can operate in a fair market. We will continue to focus on areas including anti-competitive conduct concerning livelihood issues, cartels that aim to take advantage of public funding, and conducts affecting digital markets. Thank you. Members who would like to put questions can press the button. There are 6 members who have pressed the button. I think that we should wrap up this item at 5:35 because we have another item on 3-runway system. Each member will have 5 minutes. May I remind members and the government representatives and the Competition Commission representatives that this meeting is not protected. Well, just for the Competition Commission, you're not protected by the Legislative Council Powers and Privileges Ordinance, CAP 382. The members are protected. Let me read out the names of the members who pressed the button. Mr. Chan Siu Ho, Mr. Luk Chung Kong, Mr. Stephen Ho, Mr. Adrian Ho, Ms. Doreen Kong, Ms. Chen Yong. 5 minutes per member, including question and answer. Mr. Chan Siu Hong. Thank you, Chairman. In terms of investigation and enforcement actions taken by the Competition Commission, they have achieved results, including the litigation brought against the property agencies. I hope that the Competition Commission will continue to work on combating against anti-competitive conduct. For cases originated from complaints, referrals by government, or initiated by the commission can only ask the suspected offenders to voluntarily allow the commission to conduct search, and only when the case has gone into the investigation stage can the commission mandate the suspected organization to allow the commission to search their premises or produce documents. But what if the suspects do not cooperate with the commission? That will affect the commission's efforts in gathering evidence and documents.
Looking at the figures from last June till now, there has been some 200 plus complaints. But in fact, after initial assessment, there have only been 12 plus 3 cases. So the preliminary assessment leading to investigation difficulties, how are you to resolve this problem unless you're saying that you don't have a sufficient staff? But otherwise, you should be following up each case very aggressively. So the second question is regarding Mr. Samuel Chan. He had said on a TV program that the Competition Commission, after collecting evidence, and will submit it to the tribunal for trial. It takes a long time, and that might affect law enforcement and the relevant companies and people. It takes a long time for them to hear their case. And there was an example of a school textbook case where it took more than 4 years, and the trial will only be held in April next year. So the Competition Commission has to collect evidence and then hand it over to the tribunal, and that is beyond the control of the trial is beyond the control of the commission. So after 8 years of experience, what do you think needs to be fine-tuned, Mr. Chan? Thank you for the question. Regarding the first question, I'll have Mr. Patrick Kwok handle it, and I can take the second question. Mr. Kwok, thank you for the question. I'm very happy that you have looked into our law enforcement work. As a matter of fact, the competition ordinance sets out the framework of our authority, when we can use our powers. There are some constraints. Now, as we said just now, when a case reaches the investigation stage, we can exercise our mandatory powers. We can require the parties or the individuals to submit documents. We can require the person to attend interviews. We can also make an application to the court to search a premises. But before we reach the investigation stage, we have preliminary assessment. All the interviews and investigation are based on the agreement of the investigated party, and we rely on their cooperation to obtain information. So this is one of the challenges we face. So to answer your question, every year we have some 500 complaints or inquiries. Why do we have so few investigation cases? Well, I do have good news. In the last year, in 2023, in previous years, we had 500 plus complaints and inquiries. And now it's increased to 740 plus cases in 2023. So we see a significant increase, a one-third increase. But inevitably, we see that these complaints or inquiries, the majority of them, the complainant or the inquiry, they're not familiar with the law, and they do lack a lot of substantial evidence, and early stages, and even before assessment, we know that it's a case that we cannot follow up. And in that interim period, the case might have concluded, we cannot follow up. And in fact, there are even some cases where not only are they not our case, it's some other department's case, and we have to refer it to the relevant department, and these would be concluded. So regardless of the numbers, even though we have, overall speaking, not a lot of cases, but we do take each case seriously, and this year alone we have 3 cases, and we do have cases at different stages, some at early assessment, investigation, and even at the trial stage. We have a total of 25 cases. So when it reaches this trial stage, that is the most important component. This year we have a case that is almost at the end, and there are 2 more cases that will begin trial. So our resources and staff will focus on these cases. And you cannot ask the question, your time's up. You can press for a second round. Next question from Mr. Lok Jong Hong. Thank you, Chairman. The Competition Commission, their work needs to be commended. They are a very competent team, and their powers and authorities are limited, so the public sometimes might feel, are they a toothless tiger? Well, we'll leave that for further discussion. I do think that they need to make a step forward in the amendment of the law in certain areas. Now, I do want to focus on some paragraphs. One function of the commission is to provide, is to act as an advisory body to the government and in the logistics department during procurement. We have non-competitive clauses, non-collusion clauses, and non-collusive tendering certificate procedure requirements. But the government procurement, it's not just an issue of collusion or not. A lot of times when a tender is in progress, a lot of times only the same companies are involved. Sometimes the threshold is too high, and companies that want to participate in the tender, it's too hard for them to enter the market, and to a certain degree that might serve as a monopoly or barrier. So the commission has made some suggestions on how to improve the market, so the government procurement, they can relax some of the thresholds and bring down the cost. Now, I also am aware that there is an EV recycling issue. A lot of EV users are concerned about charging costs, but the government and EV charging policy, it seems that they don't encourage competition in this area. And it, in fact, is the costliest barrier. Now, how is that the case? The housing authority or in government properties, charging facilities, there are the most expensive. They are slow charging, AC charging, and they charge $20 per hour, and they charge per hour. They don't charge per kilowatt hour. So if you overcharge, if you charge 1 hour and 1 minute, they charge you 2 hours. So the government is charging exorbitant rates, and of course the market participants will follow the government example and sell at a higher price. So will the commission suggest to the government that as a provider of so many charging facilities, shouldn't your rates be more reasonable? For example, shouldn't you charge by per kilowatt hour and not more than the market rate? You should not be the most expensive. So I'd like to hear from the Competition Commission. A lot of times in the past we talked about petroleum monopoly, and now we have electricity overcharging. Now, I'd like to respond regarding government procurement. We act as an advisory body to the government, and a lot of times we communicate with different government departments, and especially regarding procurement. But when you talk about procurement, we also need to be aware that what kinds of services or goods we're trying to procure. The government has a very stringent procedure. So we have made some interactions with the government regarding procurement. You might recall it's hard to win government tenders. In the past, we had a requirement where if you want to win a tender, you need to have conducted these types of works. And we had talked with the government about this, and in the past we had some fixed requirements. You need the relevant experience and so on. And in the waiting scheme, that has become an extra merit component. It's not a mandatory requirement. So put simply, regarding government procurement, how can we make it more competitive? We are constantly communicating with the government on this aspect. Thank you, Chairman. And EV charging? We are aware of the trend of EV vehicles. And as you said, in government car parks, we have some 74 government car parks that will charge market rates for charging, for EV charging. The rate is about $19 to $21. So how did we arrive at that figure? As far as we know, the operators that won the tender, they need to make reference to the medium charging rate of the area to serve as a basis for the tariffs. So that's our understanding. But if you are talking about charging facilities in Hong Kong, whether it is government car park or shopping mall estates, there are very different charging facilities. Their tariffs and services are different. So we do see there is some competition, but regarding the tariffs, I already told you what I have observed. Next, we have Mr. Stephen Ho. Thank you, Chairman. Now, we do need to commend the Commission for their previous work in the investigation, evidence gathering. They do face difficulties, so that's why we don't have a lot of cases. But they do serve as we do want the prosecution cases to serve as a warning. We now are concerned about bid rigging. You conducted investigation into the funeral services. We do see some business practices, and the public don't feel that it has a large impact. For example, in real estate commission, the public feels that it's customary to pay commission. So after the examples I've given, we do have social customs or norms that affect the competition. For example, if you look at the petrol stations, there's only a handful of petrol companies. And another example is certain sectors, let's say for insurance, some sectors or groups, they have a large market, but eligible companies are very limited, so they can dictate the price. So you can refer this to the Consumer Council So I feel the SARG should need to cooperate with the Competition Commission and look into this. And in paragraph 20, you say that you serve as an advisory role, and if the market is too small, there's no competition.
主席幫幫手。
You said that you have provided the government with advice on more than 25 public policies initiatives. I wonder what these policies and initiatives are about. You talked about EV batteries and building maintenance. Can you give us more examples, perhaps in writing? One last question. All these customs relating to competition matters or issues, for example, building maintenance, wage defaults, how will the government work on that? For the Aberdeen wholesale fish market that the commission have worked on, now the case has been brought to the tribunal and resolved, and after that, the practitioners did not know how to do business because they were used to the old ways of doing things, and they're asking if they should adopt the old practice. And I think that we need to have remedies after the cases have been brought before the tribunal. Thank you. Chairman of the Competition Commission, please. Let me take the second question. As Mr. Ho said, after the customs has been broken, what should the practitioners do? And of course, a lot of things are involved here. Let me give you an example. For the suspected price fixing for property agencies, we took enforcement action. The trade and the customers previously thought that they had to pay the commission rate at 2%. We worked with the property management authority, and we will be rolling out guidelines for the trade practitioners. We work with different regulators, the government and the trade, to exchange views and give them advice sometimes. We have done it, and we're glad to do so. I'm not saying that it's bad for you to break old customs, but sometimes when the companies or the property companies or the building repair companies are brought before the tribunal and they have to go bankrupt, the workers will have their wage defaulted. For the contractors who have violated the laws and after they've been brought before the court, and there is sometimes adverse consequences, as the commission is perhaps not suitable for us to take care of the consequences. Of course, when a entity commits a crime, there is always consequences. But in terms of enforcement, we act in accordance with the laws, and we take into account the seriousness and gravity of the case. What about the 25 public policies and initiatives that have been advised to the government? Is a bit difficult because these involve preliminary ideas of the government departments, and sometimes it involves initial policies drafted by the government bodies. And these policies and initiatives evolve, and it's not really possible for us to give you all the details. For the examples that we've quoted in the paper, these are the more mature kind of policies and initiatives that we can share. Please give us the policies and initiatives that you can publicize. Thank you. In writing. Mr. Adrian Ho, my team and I, when we went to the mainland and when we shopped for grocery there, we found out that for the product with the same brand, same place of manufacture and origin, The price of the same product sold in Hong Kong is threefold of that in the mainland. We know that there is difference in terms of a cost of business in different places, and that would affect the price of various products. That reminds me of the fact that some of the operators of grocery stores in Hong Kong are also land and property owners. But then for such a great discrepancy of prices among two places, I was taken aback by that. And a lot of Hong Kong people are shopping on the mainland, and the business operators find it difficult to survive. These are the problems faced by the retailers in Hong Kong. So are the retailers and middlemen in Hong Kong engaging in anti-competitive conduct? I wonder what constitutes a valid complaint for the commission to investigate into the case. In the paper, the commission says that they will not be investigating campaigns that are found to be misconceived, lacking in substance, or trivial. For us to have a better grasp of the ideas, I wonder what constitutes reasonable cause to suspect or a complaint with real content. Thank you. Who will take the question? Chairman. It is clearly set out in the competition ordinance what constitutes a reasonable cause to suspect. Say if a complainant said that they are suspected of two business undertakings conducting in cartel conduct because they sell the same product at the same price. For such kind of a complaint, we will not be investigating into it because the content is not enough. The threshold for reasonable cause to suspect is not low. We need to have substantial evidence to prove that these business undertakings have met at a certain time, at a certain location, to discuss the price to be fixed. We need more such information and data for us to take action. We cannot base our investigation on the complainant feeling that the two business undertakings are conducting in price-fixing conduct. We have to look at each and every complaint on a case-by-case basis. We cannot say across the board that when we have evidence A, B, C, and D, the complaint would definitely be substantiated. We do have to look at the complaints on a case-by-case basis. Chairman, let me supplement. Mr. Ho said that some products sold in Hong Kong are much more expensive than those sold in the mainland. Our competition ordinance is different from those on the mainland and other countries. On the mainland, they have a price ordinance. We don't have that. Let me take UK's as an example. For the relevant competition law in the UK, they have an excessive price fixing idea. But for our competition ordinance, we don't have this idea of excessive pricing. So when we see price of the same product sold in Hong Kong higher than those sold in other places, that would not constitute a reasonable cause to suspect anti-competitive conduct. If the relevant business undertakings sell products in many different markets and they may have the power to control prices, we may initiate investigation. Mr. Ho? No follow-up. Miss Doreen Kong. Thank you. Thank you, Chairman. I've looked at the key enforcement statistics, so I have two questions. first. I read that during the reporting period, for the number of initial assessment commenced and the investigation commenced, the numbers are not really high compared to the previous years. There are only two cases that have been investigated that originated from complaints received. Does that mean that the initial assessment and investigation commenced are on the decline? If that's the case, why is that? In terms of investigations, there are some cases that have been brought before the tribunal, and some times the tribunal adopt non-litigation remedies. The ratio is 1-to-1, and that's quite high in the case of non-litigation remedies. So how did you decide to bring some cases before the tribunal, and how did you decide on whether a case should be adopted or handled in by making use of non-litigation remedies? Do you think that adopting non-litigation remedies is a trend? Thank you. Who will take the question? Mr. Kwok, Executive Director, please. Thank you, Chairman, and thank you, Ms. Kwon, for the question. In terms of the numbers of initial assessment and investigations, the number could be low because there's only 12 initial assessment commenced and 2 investigation commenced. In 2023, let's say, the number of complaints and inquiries amount to 730 to 740. For each of these complaints and inquiries, we have to look into them, and among them, 12 of these complaints and inquiries were subject to initial assessment, and among them, 3 cases were subject to investigation. And when they go into this investigation stage, we can mandate the suspects to produce documents, and we can apply for a warrant to search the premises. You may think that the number is not high, but it actually takes time for us to look into each and every complaints and inquiries. Why is the number so low? In fact, not a lot of people know what the Commission is empowered to do under the Competition Ordinance. Sometimes within 1 and 2 phone calls, we sometimes realized that the calls are not really relevant to our work, and sometimes the case really has nothing to do with Competition Ordinance, and sometimes we have to refer the case to other law enforcement agencies. For a lot of the cases, the complainants cannot provide us with any substantial evidence. Sometimes they just told us what they saw on the street when they went shopping. And sometimes they told us that they thought that there was conspiracy and anti-competitive conduct involved without providing us with any substantial evidence or information. We received a lot of such calls every week. Sometimes people called us to know more about the Competition Ordinance. They sometimes ask us if what their companies are doing violate the anti-competitive conduct or violate the Competition Ordinance. For the 3 cases that's under investigation, and meanwhile, we're still following up on other cases. As to how we achieve enforcement outcomes, should we bring the case before the tribunal, and should we adopt non-litigation remedies? That depends on the gravity of the case and the parties involved, as well as how long ago the case happened. If the criminals or the involved companies. Well, we also have to look into the rank of the offenders in their companies. And also we have to look into the effect of the case to the market. That's included in our enforcement policy, and we have to look at each and every case individually before we decide on whether we should bring the case before the tribunal or adopt non-litigation remedy.
Thank you. Next, Mr. Chan Yong. We need to confirm that the Competition Commission has undertaken a lot of work, and it is obvious to the public. So when you compare the mainland to an international scene to Hong Kong, if you look at the trial periods, some cases take 4 years, and the competition chairman is also has a legal background. So if we can shorten the time, the justice can be served more effectively. You've done a lot of work, and we are also concerned about the outcome. Now, the mainland and EU also have some experience, and will you consider making reference to that? So if we cannot do it in the short term, can we do it in the middle term? Can we strengthen our area, strengthen our efforts in these areas? So we can also import professionals and develop our own professionals. Now you have also 57 investigations, and what's the progress of the remaining cases? And some cases are dealt with by non-litigation remedies. Could you disclose a little bit more? Could you help us understand? So when there's non-litigation, how does that affect equality in society? And I think a lot of our colleagues share the sentiment that there is a lot of price fixing. So in fact, is there price fixing? Now, you need to disclose this to the public to feel so that they can feel that they can rest assured that you're doing your job. First of all, the number of court cases, I'm happy to tell you our recent experience. Our cases have been scheduled much quicker every year. We have new cases submitted to the tribunal, and you also mentioned administrative measures. Now, in fact, in the competition ordinance drafting phase, we had considered whether we should adopt administrative law procedures. And at the time, quite a lot of Legislative Council members, members of the public, were of the view that if we were to take administrative law procedure too much, the Competition Commission would have too large a power, and they should delegate some of it to the courts. So we made the decision at the time to take a jurisdictional approach. And you also had a question about litigation remedies, and recently we have a delivery platform case where we had the companies provide some commitments. So the two companies, Food Panda and Deliveroo, they had promised to, where they had agreements with restaurants, and the commission felt that some of the clauses were anti-competitive. So they were able to make some commitments to remove those anti-competitive clauses. So that case was dealt with by way of non-litigation remedies. And another issue was about oil prices, petroleum prices. The commission has a case regarding a petroleum company. But we're still in the investigation case, so we're not at liberty to disclose information. Thank you, Chairman. Any follow-up? I just want to supplement that the oil companies, we have this sentiment since childhood. We want to see the government expend more effort in this area. I believe that would give the commission more credibility, and it's a win-win for all. Next, Mr. Frankie Yick. My first question, Mr. Butt had already answered that. I was going to ask about the progress on the oil company. It's underway, and as Mr. Chan said, we would like to see a response as soon as possible because the public have been confounded by this for a long time. The second question is in paragraph 13 of your paper, you mentioned two airline companies, they propose a neutral joint business agreement, and in footnote 8 you mentioned that there is a joint co-sharing agreement. Perhaps you're talking about something else, because when you talk about co-sharing, if it's been effective for a long time, and I want to know why you propose a change. So maybe we have a misunderstanding. And the third question is in paragraph 20, you provide advisory service to the government, and you have a scheme regarding retired electric vehicle batteries. So I'd like you to explain, how is that relevant to competition ordinance? Why do you need to provide counsel to the government on this issue? Mr. Butt, the first question was about airline companies. You are correct. The co-sharing business agreement, it's different from co-sharing. Co-sharing is a separate issue. When they share, these kinds of agreements, they provide promotion and they use the same code. But to the case we're talking about is about Air Malaysia and Cathay Pacific. At the time, they proposed a metro neutral joint business agreement, and in the past they operated a route between Hong Kong and Malaysia. But if they signed that agreement, then they would be competing in the past, but after the agreement there would be just one company, there would be no competition. So we felt that was problematic, and this agreement is different from co-sharing, and they would share costs and revenue. So these are two very separate, very different agreements. Your other question was providing advice to the government on retired EV batteries. This involves licensing to business operators, and our counsel was that whether these operators, could there be more operators providing these recycling services? So that is related to competition, and we provided counsel to the government. Circling back onto the airline company issue, now when they cooperated, it would reduce competition. But if this route, let's say there are 10 airline companies offering services, and two of them want to cooperate and increase competition, so is that anti-competitive? But if you say there are only two companies providing that route, so there's only two choices, A and B, but when they merge, there's no more choice. But then if there are 10 other airline companies providing routes, so would that be a contravention of the competition ordinance? Well, Chairman, I need to emphasize, they are not merging. They wanted to sign a joint business agreement. So if they merged, currently, our aside from telecoms, we don't provide for that. But if they have other commercial arrangements, honestly, I cannot answer right now because we have to look at their business arrangement and see what it involves. For example, in their previous agreement, they might have issues relating to prices. So we have to look at the clauses one by one. So aside from regulating telecoms, where we don't have merger rules, Ms. Yong Hoyan. Now, there were previous reports, Chairman, and there was an interview on a radio that in the last 9 years we had 15 cases that were tried by court, and we had 18 business entities and 24 individuals that were prosecuted. But it's not a small number, but the commission did agree that it took a long time to come to trial, and we see that the tribunal in April, as the end of April, they only have one case, and in June, they have three cases scheduled. In July, there are two cases, and August, two cases, October, one case, and January next year, one case. So we see the tribunal workload doesn't seem very heavy, just one or two cases per month, and some months they have no cases at all. So I would like to ask, where is the bottleneck now? Why does it take so long to reach the trial stage? Is the court not available, or are the parties both busy? What's the reason for the bottleneck? Chairman, you are correct. If you put aside simple cases, CMC, then the remaining full trials. Now in April, we held a 30-day trial, and it's already at the closing stage. And our next case is in August, mid-August. It's a 20-day trial, and in October, it's also scheduled 20 days. So if you just look at the cases alone, in this year, we have three cases. The caseload is not heavy, and there are different reasons. One being, when a case is scheduled for 20, 30 days, both parties, there might be more than two parties, there might be three or four legal teams. They have to juggle the workload, and the court also has to juggle their schedule. So when we have long trials, when we have big cases, it takes a long time. And the tribunal relies on one senior judge, and the other judges in the court of first instance, they can also judge over these cases, and when circumstances are appropriate, we can have more judges preside over the tribunal cases, and that can expedite the case flow.
Chairman, have you reflected to the judiciary that perhaps we can make use of more than one court to handle such cases so that experienced judges can participate in the competition tribunal. Have you reflected to the judiciary that the bottleneck is with scheduling? Because some of the cases take 20 days and some take 60 days. And commission takes years for to collect evidence and interview witnesses and so on. If the bottleneck is at the courts, have you reflected to the judiciary the issue and how do they respond to your inquiry? Thank you. We've reflected the issue to the judiciary in different ways and through different channels. We believe that the judiciary is very busy. I believe that they have taken a look at the problem seriously. As mentioned, we have some good news and the scheduling of the cases have been faster recently, and hopefully we will have our cases scheduled earlier in the future. As we rely on the court to try all the cases, we are bound to be constrained by the time factor. Thank you. There are two members who would like to speak. If there are other members who would like to speak, please press the button now. Ms. Yong, there's no time for a second round. Okay, so we will allow Mr. Yim Kong, Mr. Yu Pak-leun to speak, and then we will conclude this item. Mr. Yim Kong, thank you. Our country want to achieve and build a competitive market in the Greater Bay Area. The Commission have been working with the counterparts in the Greater Bay Area to help the business to understand the competition regime in the Greater Bay Area. I support that. Some of the municipal and provincial governments provide support to their local business. Take aviation industry as an example. Those aviation companies in Guangzhou, Shenzhen, they increased their routes to 3. When these companies fulfill certain conditions, they can receive $10 million subsidy and incentives from the government. These provincial and municipal governments support their businesses monetarily, but our cargo business rely on their own without any support from the government. So will the administration enhance collaboration with the businesses in the Greater Bay Area and nurture a healthy, competitive market? Thank you. Who will take the question? Mr. Chen. As for formulation of business and how we can do that to facilitate businesses' operation, that's not within the purview of the Competition or Commission, perhaps. But as for collaboration with our mainland counterparts, we attach importance to that. And we have worked with the Guangdong Administration for Market Regulation and the State Administration for Market Regulation. We've been liaising with them all along. We believe that as long as issues are related to Guangdong Administration for Market Regulation, we will work on those together with our mainland counterparts in the Greater Bay Area. As mentioned, in July, we've signed a memorandum of understanding with the GDAMR, and in October last year, we went to Nanjing and attended the international summit organized by the State Administration for Market Regulation. I just attended an international forum organized by the U.S. Lawyer Association. So we have been liaising with international and mainland bodies. Mr. Yim, any follow-up question? I know that you can promote fair competition in the Greater Bay Area. This is my request. Thank you. Next, Mr. Yu Pak-leon. We can only improve when there's competition, and the consumers will be the ones to benefit at the end of the day. I have a follow-up question. According to paragraph 13, there's a mention of the metal neutral joint business agreement. For example, if there is a route that no airline companies want to operate, and two airline companies want to operate the same route together, would that be in violation of the competition ordinance? Because we want to encourage airline companies to create new routes. For routes leading to Middle East or some places, sometimes there's not enough passengers for a single company to operate. If we allow two airline companies to work together to operate a single route, is there a problem? Who would take the question? Mr. Butt, CEO, please. It depends. Under the competition ordinance, for joint venture, that's allowed. But it depends on the case. If there is no one, no single airline companies operating the route, because no single operator is capable to operate that relevant route on their own, and it's only possible for two airline companies to collaborate and operate the same route, that's probably okay. But that only applies to the conditions that I just said. Any follow-up question? I don't think that he has answered my question. For the example that I just quoted, if, say, the Malaysia Airlines give up on the route and Cathay Pacific also give up on the route and no airline operators is operating that route, what happens? Can two airline companies jointly operate the same route? That will affect passengers. So you're saying that if there are two airline operators jointly operating the same route, is that possible? Right. Anything to add? Let me look at this from another angle. May I refer you to the competition ordinance for business transactions and business activities? They involve collaboration between different businesses. And in the process, sometimes anti-competitive conduct is involved. For the first conduct rule, it involves cartel conduct. For second conduct rule, it involves whether the company is with substantial degree of market power so that they can abuse the power by engaging in conduct that has the object or effect of harming competition. We encourage business with a substantial degree of market power to continue to lead the market and promote technology. This is what is encouraged by the competition ordinance. Sometimes, even when two businesses with substantial degree of market power work together, that's not against the competition ordinance. If that results in more choices for the customers, lower price, and development of the industry. All these are encouraged. If the benefits brought to the market outweigh the gray area, that would be allowed under a lot of the competition laws in many jurisdictions. We've concluded this item. Thank you, Chairman of the Commission, CEO, and the Executive Director. Thank you. Thank you, Chair, and thank you, members. Now we will move on to the next item, update on the development of the three-runway system at the Hong Kong International Airport, Hong Kong IA. We have with us officials from the Transport and Logistics Bureau, Civil Aviation Department, and representatives of the Airport Authority, Hong Kong. Welcome, officials from the TLB, Transport and Logistics Bureau, and representatives from the Airport Authority, Hong Kong. May I remind the government representatives and the Airport Authority representatives that what you say in this meeting will not be protected by the Legislative Council Powers and Privileges Ordinance, or just the representatives of the Airport Authority. Who will walk us through the paper? Mr. Samson Lam, you will make a presentation, is that right? I will give a brief presentation, and then our members from the Airport Authority will be giving a detailed presentation. Well, then we don't have time to ask questions. Let's skip the PowerPoint presentation because we only have 1 hour for the item. Well, there is a video in the PowerPoint presentation, and there is some information for the member. But why don't we just watch the video? And then you answer questions from the members. I'll give you 10 minutes for the presentation. Chair, I have a very simple opening remarks to give. Please be very brief because we have to end this meeting at 6:30. Chair, members, from the construction of the three-runway system to now, we have farmed about 650 hectares of land. The third runway lasting 3,500 km, along with the supporting facilities, utilities, and facilities have been completed. In July 2022, the third runway has been in operation, and the center runway has been cordoned off for the construction of the third runway system. This year is the key year for the construction of the third runway project. The Airport Authority have been pushing ahead with the system in accordance with the schedule. We hope to complete it by this year so that we can meet the long-term aviation demand and to consolidate our position as an international aviation hub. While we implement the construction works, the Airport Authority has been working with the stakeholders and the Civil Aviation Department to prepare for the commissioning of the three-runway system. The pilot testing will start in August of this year. For other statutory procedures, they have been implementing on schedule. We target in November to grant from the Civil Aviation Department, the aerodrome license. Shortly, we will give you a video to watch so that you will know more about the progress of our project.
So three colleagues will give a presentation regarding the finances and progress, engineering progress. Thank you, Chairman. So we now have the video. So as per Chairman's instructions, we'll show you the video now. If you have questions, you can press the speak button. Now we have nine colleagues with questions. 4 minutes each. Mr. Chan Siu Hong Dang Gabiu, Benson Lok, Dr. Hoi Simon Lee, Lok Zhong Hong, Diu Park Leung Chan Yong, Edmund Wong, and Yim Gong. Thank you, Chairman. According to the paper and the introduction, the third runway system engineering works are on schedule and they should be able to complete it by the end of the year. And the paper refers to 141.5 billion budget. We should be on budget. So I have two questions. Paragraph 10 says that the works would include the infrastructure and passenger facilities, and they will implement or convene their services in phase. So if we want to quantify the figures, how many passengers do we need to open those services? And when you say it's going to be open in phases, is it by region, or are you referring to the passenger terminal? And could the government and AA respond? Second question is about paragraph 17, where by November they will receive the license, and the license will cover the north runway and the current runway, and we have the associated taxiways and supporting facilities and the center runway. So I want to ask CAD and AA, what measures do you have to ensure that the center runway will be completed by November 2024 and the temporary runways can phase in with the runway? And when you convert over to the new system, will you be doing it overnight or will you be doing it in phases? And how will the foreign airline companies adjust to that? And when the new old system handover, will there be any risks? Are there any is there any risk of error occurring? And in the handover procedure, what special measures are you undertaking? I'll have Mr. Yu, Mr. Stephen Yu. Well, I'll respond to passenger figures first. Before COVID, that is 2018, there were some 75 million passengers per year and roughly 200,000 per day and 200 flights per day. Now, if you look at the most up-to-date passenger and airline figures in Christmas and New Year, it was 160,000. So it's 80% of the maximum and 1,000 takeoffs per day, takeoffs and landings. So if we want to get back to previous levels, we expect it to reach that by end of the year. And the design of our can handle 75 million passengers. So in our last update, we mentioned that why we have to conduct the work in phases, because if the passenger levels don't reach that, then the two passenger terminals will be operating at low efficiency. So we have to look at the growth in passenger levels, and we are keeping a close eye on the situation. I don't have a fixed date in mind, but we expect T1 to handle some 80 million passengers. So these are the only figures we have. So does that mean that if we don't reach the passenger numbers by end of the year, so even if a third runway is completed, you won't open the terminal? So our report this year was that we would definitely have three runways operating, but the passenger terminal, including the passenger lounge, we will open them in phases. So I'll answer the second question. Then in our operation preparation, we have a series of measures. First of all, in July, August, we have to ensure that the center runway meets the international aviation standards, and we have to conduct flight checks. We have to check the runway. We have to check the ground lighting system and civil aviation lighting requirements. So when we reach the standards, then we can conduct a 3-month familiarization for airline companies and relevant companies. They can do their different training and simulations so that we can open the center runway by November, and after November, the three runways can slowly reach their capacity. So it takes roughly half a year to increase the number of flights. Next, Mr. Tangapiu, regarding the third runway system, I do feel connected to it because I'm representing the outlying islands. I had to do a lot of public consultation, deal with the community relations, and I had a lot of communication with the outlying islands. And in the labor advisory board, we needed workers for land reclamation. We had to import workers. We had to import workers at different stages, and the labor advisory dealt with it in a very reasonable manner. And so I am happy to hear that the works can be completed by 2024, and I participated in the project. So my question is, we spent so much money and time on the project. So what is the work safety situation? How many fatal accidents have we had? Did we have any fatalities? And what about injured workers? Do you have any statistics? How do you handle construction site safety? Now, this is a 100 billion project, and we needed to issue government, we had to issue bonds, and the AA had to go into debt. So are you on budget? Were you able to save money? Because I understand the construction material prices had fallen. And last question is, could you explain In the video, I see that you introduce a rail system. It should be a driverless, autonomous driving system. So I want to ask, what driving system have you implemented? On the construction site-ish question, and regarding the financing, I'll have my other colleague respond. And Mr. Yu can respond regarding the rail system. Now, regarding site safety, I'll first talk about the fatalities. Direct fatalities, I need to check. There should only be one. We had a death, but then after clarification, it wasn't a work safety issue. Now, regarding overall safety, we do have standards, AFR, and we are a single digit, and the average figure is 5. So overall in Hong Kong construction industry, it's roughly 20 odd, and we are in single digits, so but we do feel we can improve, and they are minor injuries, and the management, we invest more resources. If you're interested, I can provide an independent presentation, because we do have some technical legal issues. I can talk about the APM and the when the airport opened in 98, we had an autonomous driving system, and it was state of the art at the time, and we are now introducing a new series, and in the future it would all be automated, driverless, and in T2 passengers can shuttle back and forth between the lounge. Financing, Mr. Julian Lee, regarding the debt financing, we are on budget, and overall speaking, we are going to complete the project within budget, and but there are some fluctuations, and we had COVID for 3 years, and that had affected our income, and as a result, we had to issue more debt. But overall, we do have sound financing, and you can say that we are just on budget, and we're not going over budget. Thank you, Chairman. We see that the three-runway system, it should come into operation by the end of the year. There's been a lot of media publicity. That's good news, and the international airport is now providing civil aviation and private jet services. So that sounds good. It sounds seamless, from customs clearance, luggage handling. It's all simplified. Now, I believe these services, when the three-runway system is in operation, so the high value, the commercial passengers will benefit from these services. So we expect commercial capacity will increase. And I think we need to have sufficient landing slots to facilitate this type of business. And before the pandemic, the business sector found that services were lacking in this area, and they had to divert flights to Macau rather than land in Hong Kong. So I'd like to hear from the government, when the third runway is in operation, how do you ensure that private jets and commercial flights have sufficient landing slots in Hong Kong? That's the first question.
Second question. If the 3RS can be fully utilized, it will be able to accommodate 182 airline companies. There are a lot of airline companies that want to increase new routes to Middle East or second to third tier cities on the mainland. Does the administration have any measures to encourage our local airline operators to create new routes to consolidate our position as an international aviation hub? Thank you. Thank you, Chair. There are two questions for the situation with the commercial flights. I will ask Mr. Yu to take the question. And for the other question, Mr. Yu will also answer that. Mr. Yu, Executive Director, please. Thank you, Chair. Hong Kong is an international financial center. We attach importance to commercial flights as a result. We can accommodate 69 flights at the peak hours for our two runway systems. And all the landing stops are taken up all the time. And sometimes it's difficult for the commercial flights to land. Despite such difficulties, we have special system in place for us to reserve some slots for civil flights. And before the pandemic, every day we have 20 to 30 civil flights that can land. And after the pandemic, the quotas has gone up to 120. Progressively, we will increase our landing slots. So there will be more opportunities for the business or commercial flights to land. For the 650 hectares of land to be farmed, that will not be developed in one go. There will be some slots that will be reserved for commercial flights for parking. As a result, the commercial flights will be able to land more easily. For the second question, so Hong Kong is an international logistics hub. For international long-haul route, we have some ideas. After commissioning of the three-runway system, we will encourage international long-haul routes. For Belt and Road countries, we will reach out to them directly. And we will work on that. Thank you. Next, Dr. Homi Simon Lee, please. Thank you, Chairman. For the operation of the airport and the construction of the three-runway system, I commend them. I have two questions regarding the economy and economic performance. Three-runway system will generate economic benefits. We have a new Terminal 2 and the Hong Kong CEC and the Hong Kong Macau Zhuhai Bridge. We have to link all these up for the three-runway system to give full play to its effect. So how will the government achieve this? My second question. There's been much discussion relating to the air territory, and that will affect how many flights we can accommodate. And what is the situation with that currently? Because competition is fierce within the region, and some of our neighboring airports are expanding. Do we have any new methods or technology to increase the flights that we can accommodate? Thank you. Who would take the question? For the issues relating to economy of airport island, I will ask Mr. Yu to answer that. Thank you. For Hong Kong International Airport, we don't just serve Hong Kong, but the passengers in the Greater Bay Area, amounting to some 86 million passengers. A decade ago, we had a C2 air system. Passengers can take vessels to the airside area of the international airport, and then they can take airport. And we also have an enclosed bus system. For Macau and mainland residents, they can take the coach to come to the airside area of Hong Kong International Airport by making use of the Hong Kong Zhuhai Macau Bridge. We have different hubs. Currently, we have 19, and we will increase it to 30. For the airside area in Hong Kong Zhuhai Macau Bridge, we will build two car parks. We have a park and fly system for transit passengers, and we also have a park and exit system for passengers to enter Hong Kong and spend. All these measures will allow the airport to link up with the Hong Kong Zhuhai Macau Bridge and other facilities connecting the cities in the Greater Bay Area. Deputy Secretary, Assistant Director General from the CAD, regarding the issues with airspace in 2014, the Hong Kong International Airport Authority and the Civil Aviation Administration of China have established a tripartite working group together with the Civil Aviation Authority of Macau SAR to formulate measures to harmonize airspace and air traffic management arrangements. We have achieved results. For example, we have increased external routes and airspace transfer locations. All these measures will allow us to release more airspace and to rationalize aviation traffic so that we can have a smoother air traffic. Developments of the Greater Bay Area has been going on rapidly, and there is a cluster of airports in the area. The tripartite working group has been working on how to improve the development of the airspace. One of the things that we are discussing is how we can make use of new technology, new GPS, to improve the aviation industry. Under this premise, the CAD and the Airport Authority are confident that we will be able to achieve our goals in the airspace that we have, that is to cater to 120 flights every hour. Next, Mr. Lok Chung Hong. Thank you, Chairman. I would like to ask about manpower. There was a case of corruption involving rebate and a false agreement last year relating to the Three-Runway systems project, and the relevant persons have been prosecuted and arrested. And there were business disputes among contractors and subcontractors. As a result, some of the workers have their salary defaulted. Although we are at the end of the construction of the Three-Runway system, I wonder what measures the authority have to prevent such things from happening again. With the Three-Runway system in place, we will enhance our service. You may need to hire more people. And we have this supplementary labor scheme. The imported workers are not really happy when they work on the Three-Runway systems. 70% of the workers have their overtime decreased. Sometimes it's not always better to have overtime work, but with less overworked hours, their salaries would decrease. And the imported workers are hired at a level of median income level. And some local workers are paid at a salary lower than the medium income level. And sometimes the local workers are paid less compared to their mainland counterparts. How does the Airport Authority encourage people to work on the Three-Runway system? I suggest the AA providing transport subsidy to their workers, not just for the imported workers, but all frontline workers working in the airport. Also, the authority should improve the remuneration offered to their workers. I wonder what the measures they have. Thank you. Who will take the questions? Chair, for the first question relating to disputes among contractors, I will ask Mr. Leung. As for imported workers, the Assistant Director General will take the question. Mr. Leung, for the cases in violation of the ICAC ordinance, we have improved our contract management after having consulted the ICAC, and we have stepped up communication with our contractors, and we stress that we don't allow any criminal act. As for business disputes between contractors and subcontractors, we have learned a lesson, and as the owner of the three-runway system, we try to mediate between contractors and subcontractors in order not to have the progress affected and the repetition damaged. Thank you. Thank you. Regarding importation of labor, we have heard people saying that local workers don't have as many overtime hours after importation of labor, and that affect their take-home pay. We don't want any workers to work overtime to an unacceptable level. However, we need to maintain a fair market for the local workers to meet the demand of the local workers. As to how we encourage workers to work at the airport authority, the airport authority help the contractors organize job fairs. In the middle of this month, at the Hong Kong Convention Exhibition Center, there will be a career expo. And we have organized job fairs at trade unions. As for the supplementary labor scheme, we provide transport subsidies to workers. We will look at the effectiveness of the scheme to see if it will attract more imported labor to work at the airport island. Mr. Yu Pak Leung, I would like to thank the airport authority for reporting to us the progress of the three-runway system, and I'm glad to hear that the system will be commissioned by the end of this year. We are concerned about the development of the three-runway system. Hopefully, this will turn a new page for the international airport. I have three questions. First, regarding the construction fee of the airport. Now, it's charged at $90 to $160. Is been charged since 2016. Is there any room for downward adjustment for the construction fee of airport? Because for the tourism industry and passengers making use of the airport, they want to have their burden alleviated. As for the supply of labor, upon commissioning of the three-runway system, when all the hardware are in place, we need people to operate them. So we're concerned about the manpower issues regarding the commissioning of the three-runway system. And when will we have the study on the manpower needed for the operation, and will the supplementary labor scheme help?
The third question is, I can see in a paragraph 10 that you will open the relevant passenger facilities in phases. Does that mean T2 will not be used temporarily? And when we don't have enough convention exhibition facilities, can the T2 entertain other uses? The operation in phases, I'll have Mr. Yu respond, and Deputy Secretary can answer the labor issues. Mr. Li, regarding the airport construction fee, during the pandemic, our debt went up, and up till now, our total debt is 120 billion, and our colleague mentioned the third runway system will commence in phases, so it's difficult to assess the finances. The difficulty we encounter now is we are servicing more debt, and it takes time to recover, and we are looking at when we can stop the charge. Because we don't have sufficient passenger levels, T2 and T2 Lounge will not be in operation. We will complete the construction, but if you want to make it available for other uses, then we're afraid when passengers return, we won't be able to switch. So we want to keep it and provide passenger services. Now, when we had the labor importation scheme last year, there was a ceiling because the AA did an assessment for us. They looked at the number of frontline staff needs and the requirement was that we recruit locally as much as possible. So you are correct. When we operate the third runway, we will need more staff, but it will occur gradually. And we are inviting AA to do a manpower survey. So the information we gather from that, we'll also look at the Hong Kong manpower, and we'll see if there is any fine-tuning needed in the labor importation. Next, Mr. Tan Yong, I feel that the HKIA is the centerpiece for our logistics industry, and we have been working very hard to see the results, and I do have some questions on how we can do a better job. After the works are completed, it will be in operation by the end of the year. So how can we have more mainland passengers and local passengers? So we need to streamline our immigration arrangements. We have to look at the GBA, customs, and we need to have smoother cooperation between the GBA cities. And another issue is manpower. We understand that Hong Kong has a manpower shortfall, but when the third runway system is in operation, will there be a severe manpower shortfall? And what can we do in advance such that we can meet our goals? I'll have Deputy Secretary answer. Well, having co-location arrangements between Hong Kong and the mainland, we already have that in place in West Kowloon. Hong Kong Shenzhen governments in the Huanggang border control, we are looking at making it convenient for passengers. So whether it is for leisure or business, cultural exchange, we can make it more convenient. Now in Hong Kong IA, whether it is between Hong Kong and mainline air routes or international flights, the AA has been rolling out different measures to make it more convenient. So that can make the airport attractive and competitive. Now, we are aware that some members of the public have raised the suggestion of co-location immigration arrangements, and I think you can understand that when you compare co-location agreements for rail services, that would be different from airline traffic, and that is aside from the legal perspective. So we do need to conduct research into this. So what kind of preparation work can we do? Well, it has to be with the mind, we have to bear in mind how to make it convenient for passengers. So we do have different measures between the GBA cities and Airport Island. We have a car park in the future in the Hong Kong Zhuhai Macau Bridge. The vehicles, they can park, and the passengers don't need to go through border control. They can use the airport and they can take flights out of Hong Kong. They don't need to travel through Hong Kong territory. So we will continue with these measures. We still have two members in the queue, so we'll extend the meeting by 15 minutes. Mr. Yim Gong, thank you, Chairman. The AA expects traffic figures to recover by the end of the year, and traffic, we expect freight to increase by 9%, and the Hong Kong's cargo capacity will improve, and we will see an increase in freight, in cargo freight, and also passenger traffic. So we do hope that we can reach new heights, and I'm very confident personally. So in order to strengthen our ties with the mainland, just now we heard from AA that you have 19 passenger terminal, and you also have the Hong Kong Zhuhai Macau Bridge car park facility. These are very attractive for our mainland passengers. They can use Hong Kong as a transit point. Now we are concerned about Europe and Japan. They have close connections between rail and airport traffic. So we would like to have connection with the mainland high-speed rail network. So has AA done some research and study into this area? Mr. Stephen Yu, the rail and air traffic cooperation, we have been meeting with our counterparts, and the West Kowloon high-speed rail and airport railway link are not too far apart. So our thinking is that we should not be confined to Hong Kong. we can look at Shenzhen North and Guangzhou South, where they have high-speed rail networks. We can assist passengers to receive their luggage. But we now have customs problems. Their luggage cannot travel directly to Hong Kong. So in West Kowloon, if passengers take high-speed rail, we have a Hong Kong airport luggage handling facility. So they can use their boarding pass and take this airport rail to the airport. So we will communicate with our mainland counterparts to have a rail to air network as in Europe. Any follow-up? No? Next, Mr. Dr. Zhao Mangong. The third runway, in the first year of this legislative year, we had conducted a helicopter tour, and I understand that this is very important for Hong Kong's future economic development. So some media are concerned about Hong Kong's logistics role, and aside from more publicity and adding more routes, we also have to look at our infrastructure policy. Now, previously, there were discussions about vehicles from the mainland traveling to Hong Kong. So we want to encourage more people to use our facilities. And secondly, we see we have drone logistics, a low flight economy. So this might be a new economic development. So can we do planning in this area in advance? Can we do some studies into this area? And lastly, I heard the officials mention the labor importation amounts to 6,300. And if you look at the statistics, in March, we had imported 2,000 technical staff. So in other words, do we have sufficient manpower now? Or do we need more labor importation this year? I'll have Deputy Secretary answer the first part, and the AA can talk about labor importation. Regarding Hong Kong, Zhuhai, Macau, automatic car park, the legislator is correct. The first phase of construction should be completed by the end of this year, and our plan is that by end of the year, we can start operation. The car park, it's called Park and Ride. They can leave their vehicle, and the vehicle, they do not need a Hong Kong vehicle registration. They don't enter Hong Kong jurisdiction. So for mainland passengers, they can drive their vehicle and transit out of Hong Kong. So we feel that this will attract a large number of passengers. So Hong Kong Airport is not only serving Hong Kong, it can serve the whole GBA. And let me jump to the third question regarding labor importation. Is it sufficient? Now, last year, when we introduced the scheme, it was because AA did a manpower survey, and the whole airport island, from last year till the end of this year, we expect them to recover to 100% pre-pandemic levels. So at the time, the quota was about 6,300, We have not fully utilized the quota. We expect that by the next quarter we can entertain new applications, and the airport authority will conduct a new survey to see whether they need another round, a fourth round of labor importation.
What about the low attitude economy? Civil Aviation Department, please. Thank you, Ms. Dr. Chow, for the question. Regarding low attitude economy, the government has been looking at the relevant development in various countries over the world and the mainland. In terms of use of unmanned drones, we have a cap 448G. This regulation allows unmanned drones to fly in various areas. In Hong Kong, as for airport, we have a restricted flight area for unmanned drones. For these drones to fly in the airport, they have to apply to the airport authority, because there could be conflict between the flight paths of the unmanned drones and the aircraft. Sometimes airport authority have to take videos making use of the unmanned drones. They can apply to the CAD. When it's safe, the CAD will allow the airport authority to make use of unmanned drones to undertake some works or take videos. We've been monitoring the relevant development on the mainland and other countries. Thank you. We have concluded all the items today. Thank you, representatives from the government and airport authority. There being no other business, well, if I may remind members that if you want to participate in the discussion of the culture, tourism, and sports integration, you can sign up for it. For the next meeting of this panel, that will happen on the 4th of June, 4:30 p.m. Thank you.